Hello, hello, hello. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. We're so excited to be here. We're so excited to have our special guests here. We're also fangirling internally. This is super exciting. Thank you so much for joining today's panel, AAPI Solidarity in Action, AAPI Communities Shaping Democratic Futures. My name is Aisha Islam. I'm a second year master's in public policy student here at the Kennedy School. I'm also an ASH Center AAPI fellow. I'm also here with my colleague and dear friend Early, who will also introduce herself. First, we want to start with the land acknowledgement. The land on which Harvard sits is the traditional territory of the Massachusetts people, which is a place that has long served as a site of meeting and exchange among nations. This land acknowledgement also feels particularly important for today's topic, given we'll be discussing American imperialism, colonialism, and there's really no way to talk about those without the context and reference and centering of the violent American expulsion of natives from this land and from all the lands. So that feels really important. We also want to thank the co-sponsors of this event, the Ridge Valley Foundation Institute for Asia, as well as several student groups at HKS, which I can see leaders and members of among the crowd, the AAPI Caucus, the Muslim Caucus, and the Bangladesh Caucus.
Thank you, Aisha. And just wanted to add that this panel is being recorded and the video will be shared on the ASH Center YouTube page during the Q&A session, which will follow after the panel. Please wait, or should you want to ask a question or give remarks, please wait until a mic gets to you before speaking. And this ensures that viewers watching the recording can hear your questions. And just a brief introduction, our moderator today is Professor Tony Sage, the director of the Rajawali Foundation Institute for Asia here at the ASH Center, as well as the Dae Woo Professor of International Affairs. So without further ado, I'll pass it off to Professor Sage.
Well, thanks. Before starting, I want to thank Early and Aisha for all the work that they've put into the preparation for this. They've done an amazing set of background work, research, and so it's really due to them that we're able to pull this together. I want to thank everybody for coming here and joining us for this, and also those who are going to be joining online, including my daughter, I think, who'll be watching this with great interest. So one of the things we want to do is try and explore the dynamic role of AAPI communities in terms of advocacy, grassroots liberation movements, and of course, social activism. So out of that, there's going to be certain themes I think we'll touch on. And of course, many of these may also come up in the Q&A period around solidarity, interconnected struggles for self-determination, shared experiences of marginalization, and also trying to collect, contextualize within that AAPI activism. And we're very lucky to have two great guests with us who are going to help thread our way through that maze of intersecting issues. And here on my left, we have Phit Yen Nguyen, who is a university professor at the University of Southern California, has received many fellowships along the way, has also, as you know, I'm sure everyone here has written the Pulitzer Prize-winning novel, The Sympathizer, as well as various other acclaimed works. In many ways, I think what is maybe most relevant to what we're talking about today is this one, A Man of Two Faces, Memoir, History, and Memorial, which covers through personal reminiscences many of these themes, which I just outlined. I thought it was also interesting that he doesn't come out too approving of Hollywood in terms of its role. And he talks about it feeding the American war machine and anti-Asian racism. And on my right, we have our colleague here, Shehbab Chowdhury, who is assistant director at the New York City's Mayor's Office for Economic Opportunity. And again, for our purposes today, is the co-chair of the Bangladeshi Americans for Political Progress, which is a grassroots organization mobilizing, as you would expect from the title, the Bangladeshi American community around progressive values, civic engagement, and electoral politics. He also, I didn't know this, spearheads a docu-poetics project on immigration and belonging in America, and is the co-founder of the sustainable fashion brand Sabra that honors actually Bangladeshi weaving traditions and fabrics. Okay, so let me start with a kind of broad question, just to kind of set the stage for everybody here, which is just if you want to share a little bit about your background and what are the communities, spaces, or spaces that resonate most with you. And why don't I start with you first, Vietnam?
Thanks so much, and thanks for having me here. Hello, everybody. Never thought one day I would speak at the Kennedy School of Government. No, I have no idea what I'm doing here, but yes. You know, I was born in Vietnam and came to the United States as a refugee, obviously because of the war in Vietnam, and that history has shaped my life. It's certainly a history that is that your school is probably very concerned with in different ways. I approached it as a deeply emotional issue for me, an emotional issue that connected me to politics, war, refugee experience, representation, and so on. And I decided early on that I wanted to become a writer, and that my way of coping with becoming an accidental American by no choice of my own was to work out what that meant through scholarship, through art, through writing, through this idea that now has a lot of currency in this world that we're talking about of narrative change. All of a sudden, narrative change is on the agenda for so many foundations and policy organizations and things like that. And I guess that's a good thing because it does speak to a very fundamental truth that I'm involved in, which is that narratives are in fact very powerful. In one sense, they're art, which is what concerns me, but narratives drive our policies and our wars and our understandings of history. And the wrong narratives, I think, took the United States to Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. And arguably, the United States has learned the wrong narratives from that experience. And here we find ourselves post 9/11 in Iraq, Afghanistan, and supporting Israel in Gaza. To me, this is all part of the same chain of history that, for an American at least, begins at the moment of colonization and conquest. So beginning with the land acknowledgement is important, but I think what's really important is to acknowledge that the United States, and from my argument, if you read A Man of Two Faces or many other things I've written, for me to understand myself as an American is to understand myself as coming from a country born out of contradictions that have always been there. Certainly, freedom and democracy is a part of the United States. It's given me the opportunity to be a writer and to be published and to tell my stories. And yet that freedom and democracy is inextricably intertwined with enslavement, colonization, genocide, conquest, perpetual warfare that has been going on since the very beginnings of the United States. So that's me. That's why I'm here. You know, that's what my books are about. And, you know, Tony pointed out that, hey, you know, I criticize Hollywood a lot in A Man of Two Faces and in The Sympathizer. I say Hollywood is the unofficial ministry of propaganda for the military industrial complex. And so entertainments like movies, like TV shows are also serving ideological purposes as well. And it's interesting for me to think about that because there is a way in which stories have explicit functions. They tell explicit things. And then stories have implicit functions. That is the form of the spectacle of an entertainment can actually be contradictory to what the entertainment is about. So in my own work, as I think about the importance of, for example, America's Hollywood movies about the Vietnam War, they're supposed to be anti-war movies for the most part. And they've done a very interesting thing, which is they've given the world the impression that the war in Vietnam, the American War, was a bad war. Why would Americans, telling stories about themselves, cast themselves in a negative light? And this is part of the power of stories, of narratives, that you could say one thing through the content, but the form does something totally different, which is that Americans would rather be, okay, this is a quote from, I'm gonna quote myself, I love quoting myself. In The Sympathizer, I say, it's better to be loved than hated, but it's better to be hated than ignored. And I think that is the lesson to be taken out of American foreign, one lesson from American foreign policy and America's strategies via entertainment and soft power. Obviously Americans would rather be remembered for having fought good wars, but even if they fought bad wars, as long as the world's focus is on American experience, the United States still comes out the victor in the end. So that's where the questions of narrative change, narrative power, the role of the storyteller and the artist become crucial, and where someone like me hopefully can make some kind of an intervention in many of the issues that we've talked about. Unfortunately, I don't do things like engage in community politics and all these things that are really, really crucial that we should discuss. But I think there is a crucial role for the act of storytelling, even if that act of storytelling is also embedded in contradictions. Like, what does it mean for me to write a novel that can turn into a TV series by Hollywood that is itself something that I criticize? I'm all for having this fascinating, complicated conversation about contradictions that I think all of us are embedded in what we do.
Great, thanks. I mean, certainly storytelling is crucial. I mean, it's the way we run our lives, you know. First thing we do when we meet is we tell a story about ourselves. And that's the way you try and appreciate who you're dealing with. And I've always been very interested in what I call the narrative reconstruction of reality. And I think that's what you're also talking about in terms of the ideas around Hollywood. Before we get deeper into some of those, let me first turn to you, Shahab, and for same kind of question, to give us a sort of orientation around yourself, the communities, and then I have a follow-up that I want to go on to after that.
Thank you so much, Tony. Thank you, Viet. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm really grateful and honored to be here and, you know, be present with your community. And to just sort of share some of my stories and perspectives on the different realities of how AAPI communities, especially within and outside the Bangladeshi community, shape sort of the democratic futures here in the United States. First and foremost, special thank you to Early and Aisha Aslam for their incredible work. So round of applause for them. I think that, you know, what we're here to discuss today is a critical and pivotal discussion, something that doesn't really get talked about often. And I'm really excited to see how this conversation unfolds. And this is a multidimensional conversation that I hope that, you know, we're all going to participate in. And so my name is Shahab Chowdhury. I am one of the current co-chairs at Bangladeshi Americans for Political Progress, a grassroots organizing group working to build a progressive grassroots voting bloc and community dedicated to advancing Bangladeshi working class and immigrant interests in New York City and across the United States. There are over about 300,000 Bangladeshis in the United States right now as we speak, and over 100,000 in New York City in particular. Help run the city. We help, you know, keep the city running, everything from the, you know, late night cabs that people take on Friday, Saturday nights to the hospitals and elder care systems that are really run by the labor of Bangladeshi working class folks. Beyond that, you know, I belong to many communities and spaces and places, and that make me Shahab, right? I'm a son of a Brooklyn, a brother, a bhai, a kaku. I'm a public servant, an organizer, social entrepreneur, a Brooklyn-born Bangladeshi American, and a Muslim. And these identities are neither fixed nor are they fluid. They are just some things that I've permeated throughout my life, right, to make me me. To be here in this moment and this time present with you all. And I serve as a, you know, community organizer and public servant. I sort of serve the neighborhoods that I, you know, belong to and I know really well in my beloved city. In Urdu, you say Shah-e-Janan, right? A city of beloved, which is my New York City. Special place for me. I grew up there, born and raised there in Kensington, in Brooklyn, where I could experience worlds within worlds, right? The smell of all the aunties, Bangladeshi, Pakistani, Mexican aunties cooking at sunset, calling in their kids to pray Maghrib at night, turning off the lights, closing the shades. So many people running on Fridays afternoons to catch Jummah. Where after Jummah, you'd have mini World Cup tournaments at Brooklyn Parade Ground. At the parade grounds, you'd throw in your yours. And you'd hear trash talk while people are playing basketball and soccer and all these incredible sports. And on those Jummah days, as the sun set, I would watch the day of Jummah turn into the night of Sabbath and spend Saturday mornings actually turning on lights for my neighbors who are observing those Sabbaths. Would get a chance to experience and participate in all the different holidays that people participate in such a very multicultural place, multi-ethnic, multiracial place in Kensington in particular. So what resonates with me are the scents, how some scents never smelled the same way on certain days. You know, I grew up loving rosewood attar, right? So it's a specific type of attar that you put on, you know, usually when you go for like Eid Namaz or other types of celebrations, Bengali New Year, which just took place this past Sunday. And, you know, I grew up loving rosewood. Athar. And fifth grade, it's Shark Week, and we basically hear from our principal at that time, Mr. Wall, that the towers were struck, right? So I remember very viscerally being on the third floor of my school, walking up to the top of PS 230 and watching smoke come out in the far distance. And I remember inhaling the smoke of all that 9/11 debris and realizing that I could never smell rosewood in the same way ever again. So I remember inhaling the smoke and really watching it cloud my eyes and changed sort of my reality in ways that I would never expect in the days ahead as a 11-year-old boy, right? As I watched law enforcement impact my communities through surveillance, seeing uncles in my neighborhood being picked up by the FBI, seeing places where, you know, my masjids were tapped up, where, you know, people just randomly came to pray and asked a lot of really weird questions. And then even felt that when I was in college too, at, and I had people praying next to me who were informants. And so I'm here to share my stories and to be in community with you all, to talk about the tales we tell ourselves in order to live. And as Bangladeshis and Bengalis and really thinking about what our futures look like, often our labor is invisible, our work is invisible. The contributions we make to the United States are oftentimes just erased altogether, right? And so as we think about, you know, sort of how our past and present inform this particular moment in activism, as it informs sort of this revolutionary moment that we live in right now in 2024, amidst so many challenges happening on a procedural level to democracy, on a substantive level of who do we trust and who do we love and who do we value and why. I'm also here to ask some questions to you all, and I'm really curious to participate in that kind of conversation of what do we see ourselves transforming into as a collective democratic future? Where do we see ourselves, you know, how do we see ourselves transforming ourselves, coming to America and then to become, to sort of understand what is unfolding in the unseen and the gaib, so to speak. And so, yeah, I'm really excited to participate in the conversation in that way, in these ways, and to just, you know, acknowledge that, again, the very things I've yet mentioned already, you know, have shaped my lived experience and shaped the lived experiences of Bangladeshi Americans time in, time out, from colonialism, imperialism, to being survivors of genocide and ethnic cleansing, and understanding what it means to be here and to be present in this time to advance and fight for liberation and in defining what our liberation looks like in the days ahead.
Great, thanks. I now see the logic of the docu-poetics, with your kind of comments there. I think it's also important what you said, and I think everybody feels that, that we're actually members of many communities. And sometimes the trick is balancing what may appear contradictory within those communities, and maybe that's something we can come back to lately. But following on from the last of those comments, if I could turn to you, if you could just elaborate a little bit more on your scholarly work and your written work, which you obviously were stressing, how it intersects with or responds to the kind of legacies of colonialism, racism, and or imperialism, as both of you sort of highlighted in some of your opening comments?
Well, I became radicalized politically and intellectually when I went to UC Berkeley and became an Asian American. Before I went to Berkeley, I'd gone to this very primarily white high school where I got a very good canonical education, but not one that invoked in any way issues of diversity, people of color, writers of color, or any other intellectual political traditions. So becoming an Asian American was my entryway into understanding how my identity has in fact been shaped by many of the issues that we've just been discussing. And at the time, in the early 1990s, being an Asian American felt like it was still a radical thing. And we were wrestling around some of the terms that I think are already implied here in this event, AAPI, AA, APA, da 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 da. And we took it very seriously, obviously, because what we were trying to understand is exactly what does identity mean? How expansive should our identity formations be? What kinds of differential histories are being invoked? If we say we are AAPI, are we collapsing radically different experiences and histories that shouldn't be collapsed together? So I think these are ongoing questions around politics, intellectual issues, et cetera. I have to say now, however, that I have great difficulty calling myself an Asian American. I don't think it's radical anymore. I think AAPI is completely incoherent as a formation. And it has its political purposes, obviously. It has fundraising purposes. It has diversity, equity, inclusion purposes, all this kind of stuff that has become oddly very contradictory, because from an intellectual and political standpoint, DEI is, I think, you know, highly problematic. And yet at the same time, it's considered highly threatening by another faction of American society. And I think that's a really interesting contradiction to press on, because I think it is like the energies that drive something like AAPI and DEI are in fact threatening in reality to a certain faction of the United States that believes in a much more homogenous version of the country, both its history and its present. And at the same time, DEI is also, and AAPI are contradictory and incoherent, because a lot of the people who advocate for these things have not thought through the contradictions. They've stopped at the level of inclusion and identity and not thought through the materially contradictory histories. So to give you an example, like for me in the early 90s, speaking about becoming a writer, it felt that if I were to tell Asian American stories, that would inherently be a radical enterprise. Now, I think we've achieved a certain level of success as Asian Americans in terms of storytelling. And it's important that we still continue to tell diverse Asian American stories. For example, there are not enough Bangladeshi stories out there. So that imperative to tell stories and to engage in narrative change and to invoke the politics of representation and inclusion is still really, really valid. And yet at the same time, the mainstream of the Asian American coalition is deeply embedded now in the corporate military industrial mainstream of the country. I don't think that there is a lot of radical opposition left in the very mainstream of the Asian American movement. You can't even really call it a movement anymore. And so once the politics of the Asian American communities are articulated around things like representation and inclusion, you've already accepted a certain narrow bandwidth of politics. So my own writing is geared it was geared at a moment when being Asian American was radical, and now it's looking at a moment when being Asian American isn't radical. And it's around this fracture that my own writing is situated. And so another way to put it is, you know, Shahab's arguments, not arguments, but, you know, the proposition that it's important for him to speak with and for Bangladeshi American communities is absolutely right. And yet there's also a deep limit to that from my experience as a Vietnamese American. So for example, you know, a lot of Vietnamese Americans hate me. Okay. And they hate my work. They hate what I stand for. They told me to my face, we hate you. And I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that, because in fact, whether we speak about ourselves as Americans or Asian Americans or APIs or Vietnamese Americans, we're not the same. And the fact that we have fractures is potentially discouraging to some people. To me, it's enormously empowering, because it means that, good, I don't have to be friends with you. You are not the Asian American I want to hang out with. You're not the Vietnamese American I want to hang out with, et cetera. And now it's clarifying. You know, we can share certain things like food and culture. That's all good. But around issues like politics, ideology, and so on, we can fracture. We have fractured in the past. We will fracture in the future. And that helps to clarify and to sharpen my own sense of my aesthetic and my politics and my commitments. And I think that when we talk about AAPI, that rubric does tend to encourage us to homogenize and to cover over, again, very serious historical differences, experiential differences, and political differences. Maybe the last thing I'll end on is the reason why I think AAPI is incoherent is because Asian Americans have been built around a narrative that had at one point been anti-capitalist, anti-imperialist, anti-war, and so on, but is now really a narrative about inclusion and claiming American identity and citizenship and nationalism. Pacific Islander formation is about indigeneity and colonization, ongoing settler colonialism, in which the American nation state still engages. So that's a huge contradiction that cannot be reconciled through an inclusionary narrative of AAPI community politics. So it's not that we can't do all these things at the same time, it's just that they are in fact contradictory, and we actually need to talk about those contradictions, because that's actually how we would advance agendas around artistic representation, political strategy, community formation. And if we don't, those incoherencies within the formation will result in actual real, not only disagreements, but potentially catastrophes when the fractures emerge.
So do you think it risks the trap of falling into stereotyping that is actually going to prevent pushing forward with a more progressive agenda?
You know, I don't even care about stereotyping anymore. I mean, it's like when I was 20 and I was like pissed off about, you know, anti-Asian stereotypes, it was enormously motivating for me as a writer. And now it's still an important issue, obviously. The stereotypes do matter. And of course, doing things like having TV series and having more faces and more voices and so on, doing Vietnamese things and Asian things is important to countering stereotypes, but that is only a representational project. I mean, and yes, we should engage in it, but the language of only talking about stereotypes and identities and identity conflicts is important, but it's also potentially deeply alluring in terms of sucking us into a kind of a politics that does not recognize that really what is crucial when we talk about identity or stereotypes or representation is the underlying historical issues around capitalism, colonialism, and so on that really matter. And so, for example, so much, and I go around to a lot of college campuses, and college students who are Asian American are still talking about the identity crisis, about being divided between their parents and American culture and Asian culture and so on. These are the same things I was talking about in the early 90s. These were the things that the Asian American activists were talking about in the 1960s. These were the things that the early Asian American writers were talking about in the early 1900s. And the fact, if we continue to talk about those things as identity crisis and stereotypes, then in fact we've lost, because identity crisis and stereotypes are only manifestations or symptoms of deeper issues. And so I tell people, look, you are not having an identity crisis. You're having a political crisis, that's an outcome of colonization and settler colonialism and perpetual warfare, in which the identity crisis is only a symptom. And if you only talk about the identity crisis, in fact, what's going to happen is that it will become commodified. You have another commodity there to try to cure your identity crisis. And then your next generation, your children or somebody else's children, will be talking about the exact same thing, because the underlying issues of power, domination, global hegemony struggles, these kinds of things that produced Asian immigrants and Asian Americans in the first place won't have dissipated.
Chad, let me turn to you. I mean, a lot of your work is a much more focused process where you're dealing with the Bangladeshi communities. So I guess I've two questions related to that. First, if you could drill down a little deeper than your opening comments about, you know, what are the key issues that you focus on in that work? And that's really interesting with what Yatan just said about, you know, an appellation of AA doesn't get us very far. Does an appellation of being Bangladeshi get us very far? Or are you also wrestling with different contexts, different identities within the community that you're most closely associated with?
Yeah, that's a brilliant question. I'll say that BAP, for short, which long version of it is Bangladeshi Americans for Political Progress, really focused on helping to build political power in New York City, specifically across the 100,000 Bangladeshis that currently live and reside there. We have, it's one of the fastest growing communities in New York City. The new neighbors report that was just recently published by the Department of City Planning suggests that it is one of the top three fastest growing communities, immigrant communities of foreign born population folks in all of NYC. This presents itself with a wide variety of different challenges, but also a lot of opportunities. I'd say that the issues that we have specifically focused on have focused historically on labor rights and labor organizing, specifically helping to mobilize communities, the Bangladeshi communities, during sort of the New York City, New York Taxi Workers Alliance sort of medallion debt relief fight. We participated and helped to do a lot of work around electoral organizing. So specifically looking at candidates that represent our actual progressive values, so values of really being not only supporting a working class agenda, but rather folks that identify and acknowledge sort of the anti-imperial roots that a lot of Bangladeshis share in commonality, given our lived experiences. Issues around access to better social service benefits, issues around a stronger social safety net, issues around access to economic opportunity as a whole. And so we organize around a lot of these issue specific areas, helping to mobilize and activate a wide variety of different campaigns and push on these issues. We do that through electoral endorsements. So we helped in 2021 to elect the first ever Bangladeshi woman into New York City council history, Shahana Hanif, which was a very, very big moment in our history. And obviously, representation, as Viet has mentioned, is like, it's not enough, but there are moments where, it's a start to being able to be at the table, right? Because if you're not at the table, you're on the menu, right? Just what it is, especially in the United States. We're in this sort of space now where we've helped to also elect other candidates like Zoran Mamdani, Tiffany Caban. And in our core principles, we're also focused on abolition, being abolitionist, and really organizing around criminal justice issues as well. And why is that? Is because we're actually deeply affected by this, right? Right here in Boston, about a year ago, a young Bangladeshi boy was killed by the Cambridge police. We see in, right, just 3 weeks ago in Ozone Park, a young boy named Win Rosario. He calls 911 himself saying, I'm not feeling well. I need help. And so instead of mental crisis service responders showing up, the NYPD shows up, and they show up and they're trying to de-escalate everyone is trying to de-escalate the situation. Wynn's mom is there physically present. Her brother is there physically present. And instead of providing de-escalation support, what we saw instead was the police shooting Win Rosario 6 times over and over and over again, right? While he was in his mom's arms. So it's been 3 weeks essentially, and no body cam footage to date. We still are waiting to hear what the next steps are, but there is a need for justice and accountability there. And these are the kind of issues that BAP in particular are organizing around, so that the family is supported, that we can get justice for Win Rosario and hold the police accountable. These are not, again, if you want to use umbrella terms, AAPI doesn't really say anything, right? It doesn't share the particular nuanced experiences that this, community and group of people that come from Asia have experienced. I think it's important to also recognize and call out that our community is faced with, Fit, you mentioned that people hate you. There's a lot of people that, there's a lot of intra-conflict fighting within the Bangladeshi community as well. And we see this arise in this particular moment in time as we see sort of, this is a deeply painful time for Muslims, obviously, for Bangladeshi Muslims as well, primarily. And it's not a monolith. There's, Bangladeshi Hindus, Bengali Hindus, Bengali Christians, Bangladeshi Christians in Brooklyn, in New York City, in the five boroughs. But for the Bangladeshi Muslim community, it's a deeply painful time given what's happening in the world. And I think it's important to call out that there are a lot of elected officials who have not called for a basic thing as ceasefire, right? just to call for the end to the cycles of violence of that are currently happening in Gaza. In this particular moment, we actually have seen a lot of Bangladeshi masjids actually invite a lot of elected officials who have not called for it and have allowed for them to speak and sort of allow for them to do what they're doing as usual, to take photo ops, to show that, look, hey, we're in strong solidarity with the community. We're representing your interests at Albany and New York City and beyond. And that is just not the case with how people actually feel and like what their actual beliefs are in terms of what they look for, just like a majority of New Yorkers are calling for a ceasefire. And in moments like this, it's led to a lot of internal conversations to hold each other accountable so that we can start somewhere on this question of positionality and what it means to engage with a political system of power in this moment in time that doesn't really have our best interest, that continuously, systematically dehumanizes us, right? Time and time again. And recognizing when that dehumanization can actually be a point of organizing so that we say no more photo ops with the ops.
Yeah, I think that's a very important area of thinking about how do you, the importance of addressing injustices that go beyond one's own community, and how you can kind of build those linkages to create more pressure, I think, becomes an incredibly important area. I want to come back to that in a moment, but let's first kind of widen the lens again. And I want to come back to some of the things that you did in your Norton lectures and also which was in the piece In the Nation, and how you see the analysis you use there, whether we call it the AAPI community or whether we call it something else, how does you see that resonating with the broader struggles for liberation, self-determination, and whether you could just take us a little bit deeper in your thinking on those issues?
Well, I think that even the very terms that you used were important. Some of the terms that we've been hearing about justice, liberation, self-determination, and all these kinds of things, these are principles, right? And there's a distinction between principles and identities. Now, when your principles and your identities overlap, that's great. And so that's why for me, at a certain time in my life, being Asian American was that moment when the principles and the identities converged. And now I think the principles and the identities have diverged. My principles have always stayed the same. My principles have always been, you know. But it took me a long time to be able to articulate those principles. They're still being articulated. I do believe in things like identity, self-determination, autonomy, and so on. But it's been a learning process for the past 30 and 40 years that's still ongoing. And as stressful as some of my experiences have been around taking a public stand on Israel's war in Gaza, it's also been enormously clarifying politically, morally, emotionally, but also theoretically as well, to be able to try to figure out, well, if I believe in self-determination, justice, and so on, how does that manifest itself in this situation? What are the ramifications for me? What are my implications? What are the limits and the possibilities of being Asian American relative to this kind of a history? And so, you know, it's important. And that's why I'm, you know, that's why I've been, you know, looking at these broader terms with you, like AAPI and so on, because it's important to know what your principles are. It's important to know what your theoretical political convictions and methodologies are. And if you know those things, you can stay true to them. And so when your alliances, your identities, your colleagues, your community fracture or diverge or conflict, then you are equipped to be able to articulate where you stand. And you brought up the internal issues in the Bangladeshi community, and that thing that's very important, because all of our politics ultimately are also very local. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we certainly should have grand theoretical articulations and understandings, but the politics are local. So for me, a lot of my politics have been driven by the fact that I came out of the war in Vietnam, and the Vietnamese were killing each other over principles and ideas and so on. And that they continued that fight as a refugee community. I mean, they were killing each other in the refugee community. It was not enough to simply be Vietnamese, because what does that even mean to be Vietnamese? I mean, I could invoke a lot of terms that make me weep, you know, the customs and the language and the rituals of the community, and yet we would still kill each other because we didn't share the same beliefs. And to understand that we didn't share the same beliefs becomes very liberating, because then I can separate the desire to have a community and all of that it entails, that's very positive, but also to separate my own political practices and artistic practices from that. And to believe that even if a substantial portion of the Vietnamese community hates me, and even if the Vietnamese government doesn't like me very much either, as far as I can tell, I think I'm actually doing work that is for them, even if they don't like it. And that's really a crucial political artistic principle. Like, even if people are disputing what I am doing, by saying I'm not being Vietnamese enough or I'm not being whatever, I think that as a storyteller and as a scholar, for me to tell my version of the truth about Vietnamese history and Vietnamese politics and Vietnamese refugees and the war and so on, that's actually good for the entire nation and community, whether they like it or not. And so there's this really compelling tension between serving the community, whatever that means, and serving truth and justice, whatever that means. And that oftentimes they are in tension and in conflict, and there's not going to be an easy resolution. And that's again, not a great place to be. It's emotionally, intellectually, politically a very difficult place to be. But from out of that, I think we produce better work. I don't know about how the community politics work as well, but from these frictions that I've had with my own community, it's clarified my own political and artistic understandings. So for example, I wrote a short story collection called The Refugees, which I think a lot of Vietnamese people like because it says good things about them, you know? And that's one function of art and politics, is to represent your community. Another function of art, however, is to provoke your community, to make your community understand its own shortcomings, its own contradictions, its own failures, and so on. And that's certainly what a novel like The Sympathizer does, or A Man of Two Faces does. And if you take up that function as trying to tell the truth for the good of your own community, you have to realize that you can no longer function as a representative of the community. Now that opens up, if your whole career is built on being a representative, what do you do with that? You know, and thankfully my career is not built on that. You know, my career is, that's why I don't want to be a community activist or a political representative. I want to be a writer. And, you know, at the level of writing, we have a different function of representation, where the real function of representation is the art itself and the truth and justice. And the question of the community or identity falls, it's secondary. It's not that it's not important, it's secondary. And so that's a different set of challenges that I have than what you have in terms of community activism, right? But it's an interesting tension, because I think both work in alliance with each other. Because I really do think that my own some of the things that I've been able to do as a writer and as a scholar have been made possible by community activism and social and political movements that have over time created openings for someone like me to come in and be a jerk and say, so I want to take advantage of this social this opportunity that my community and my movement has built, and then I'm going to say some things that the community and the movement don't like. But in fact, we operate together, because I think that if the storytellers and the scholars and the artists and the intellectuals say the truth that matters, that will have an impact on community politics as well, and vice versa.
We want to open it up to questions in a moment. But before that, I just want to bring back to the community again, because a couple of things struck me there about grassroots actions. And also a question of doing work for people who might not see it as being in their best interest. And this brings up for me the question around co-governance. And so there, you know, how do you get regular people to take seriously the need to co-govern and fight for governing power, particularly when they have very little material gains to be won in the short term? I mean, that's often the challenge, that you might see the longer term gain for this. They may only look at the short term, which may not be so beneficial. So out of your work, have you been able to see ways that you can bridge that, either whether it's with effective narrative or practical governing solutions from the work that you've been doing?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think there's definitely opportunities. I think there's a long struggle ahead on this issue of co-governance, on co-designing and being a part of, you know, processes here in the United States for participating in democracy, whether it be, you know, the lowercase d or the capital D of that. I'd say that generally speaking, so much of there is, you know, in our communities across South Asia, and especially in the Bangladesh community, you know, as survivors of genocide and ethnic cleansing. Folks come here out of, you know, the sort of forced situations that people, you know, have faced themselves in. And across the three different waves of immigration that have taken place for Bangladeshis into the United States, we see time and time again that, you know, there's a big need for economic and financial security. And it's something that I think a lot of our community, you know, pursues. That's life, right? That's sort of the situations and the material situations that people have faced time and time again as they arrive in America and sort of try to build up material wealth and success. However, there's a trade-off there in that there's a lot of disengagement in just being able to even participate in local democracies. There's oftentimes, in I think in older generations, more interest in participating in homeland politics in Bangladesh rather than in politics here. And it's something that we're trying to bridge the gap in, and really, you know, providing political education in being able to, you know, create a baseline of progressive values, centering and driving political education of why we're here, what are the key issues that are affecting New Yorkers and Bangladeshi New Yorkers, and what can we actually do about it in governance and design. And it's, you know, we've helped to do voter registration drives and help folks understand in Bangla and in English through language accessibility, just what redistricting means and what sort of, you know, what does the political education, political sort of civic situation look like in the United States. And there's a lot of work that needs to be done there. And just in even crafting and designing curricula that is accessible at a fifth grade level that can help to explain why we're even doing this. What does building political power even look like or mean? And there are incredible organizations like DESE's Rising Up Movement, DRUM, that are doing this work in collaborate, you know, alongside BOP and many other organizations. But it takes time. It takes literally years and years of like being able to build up power through membership driven organizations, through actions, through direct mass mobilization in times like this. And co-governance is not easy, but there are opportunities. There are opportunities like participatory budgeting where on a very local level, people, non-citizens, citizens alike, can actually decide where to spend their taxpayer dollars on. There are opportunities to just even provide feedback and have conversations with local elected officials, especially officials that are relying on their base, being Bangladeshis in particular. There are opportunities as well for co-governance. But it requires us to be far more systematic about how we're setting up conversations. So it's not just someone comes, shows up, says like, here's what we're doing for you. I'd like to fight for you on these things. But that rather it's a co-design process of like what democracy could look like at a very, very local level. So it could reshift power balances, that we could really actually put more power into the hands of any resident that lives in a particular area. And it's something that is, again, something that takes years. As you mentioned, I think a lot of activism and movement organizing happens in waves and it kind of dies down. And we don't see the organizational infrastructure that's necessary to be built out, actually built out. And so we're hoping to build out that ecosystem so that we can continue to generate a new pipeline of activists, of movement organizers, of movement builders across the United States. But really focus on the issues that are impacting our communities so deeply so that, you know, we speak in a way where you can't ignore us. You can't just redistrict us into five different districts, right? Like if you look at a map, a congressional map, a local city council map, and a state assembly and state senate map of New York City's district lines, and then you overlay all of the Bangladeshi top five neighborhoods, Jamaica, Queens, and Hillside, Jackson Heights, Parkchester, Kensington, and Ozone Park, you will find that each one of those districts is so gerrymandered and split into four to five different council members or state senators that there's no, like we have to wait till the next cycle to even push for that. But that's the thing, you know, we have to push at a very local level and build towards these things. You know, the oppositions and the folks that love gerrymandering and love to do reinforce a lot of the systems of dehumanization and supremacy that we do see built within, you know, the fabric of the United States, have been doing this for years, right? 40-year plans. Go read the American Heritage Foundation of what's going to happen if the Republican Party wins the presidency. So just so you can get a feel for that. And then, you know, there's internal accountability as well with other parties that exist. And so there's a lot of work ahead. It takes time, but it, you know, our communities here, we have nowhere to go, right? Can't go back to Bangladesh for so many of, you know, so many people, for whether it be for political reasons, or, you know, reasons of survival. And so we make the most out of what we can in the, you know, in the moment that we're given.
Fantastic. So we want to open it up for questions. So just three things. First, let us know who you are. Second, try and keep your comments relatively short so others get the opportunity. And remember that a question usually ends with a question mark. So the floor is open for those who'd like to get us going. Don't be shy. It's your great opportunity. Yes, I see a waving hand at the back. You have to wait for the microphone because it's also...
Thank you, Tony. And my question is for Vietnam Nguyen. We have known each other for a long time. And first, before I pose my questions, congratulations. Just wanted to congratulate you on the successful premiere of the Sympathizer a few days ago. I just can't wait to see the whole series in the coming weeks. So my question for you is, I know you have been a strong, very vocal advocate for Vietnamese perspective representation on the Vietnam War in the academia and Hollywood movie as well. So can you share with us some of the challenges in doing this? Have you ever encountered any internal conflicts trying to represent one side or the other side of the Vietnamese?
You mean just in terms of the TV series?
No, I mean, you know, within yourself.
Within myself.
And you, when you write your novel, do you feel any internal conflict, tension, trying to be balanced? Will, you know, one side or the other side of Vietnamese? You know, I know, you know, the Sympathizer is, I think, represent both sides of Vietnamese.
No. I find myself somewhat unusual in the Vietnamese American community, again, the Vietnamese are not unique. Having undergone a civil war, which apparently is a term that is not even endorsed by certain Vietnamese people, and a revolutionary war, it meant that the Vietnamese were fractured, they were intensely divided, they had really oppositional viewpoints. And for whatever reason, I've always been someone who, like my own narrator, saw every issue from at least both sides. That was something inherent in me. And so when it came time to writing about the war, I did not have a problem choosing that perspective of at least duality. I was not interested in writing a novel that would endorse one side or the other, only take up one position, because what I really wanted to get at was not simply to tell a better story about Vietnamese people or a story that had been not told before. I wanted to tell a story that got at what I thought was one of the most fundamental underlying aspects of narration and eye perception that had driven the United States to Vietnam and Indochina and had driven the conflict between the Vietnamese people. And again, that's the whole point of the Sympathizer. I think the point of the Sympathizer is not that it's a Vietnam War story, even though it is the point of the Sympathizer. It's about perceptions, dualities, empathies, and how the denial of these kinds of things are in fact what drives us to war. And the war in Vietnam was just one, I mean, it was obviously a horrifying tragedy for you and for me, but it was simply one war in terms of many different wars. So no, I didn't have any of that kind of a conflict. And so far as the TV adaptation has come along, I think that honestly, it's been about as pleasant of an experience as I could have hoped for. And I think the reason why is because Hollywood itself has shifted a little bit. Hollywood is staffed by liberals for the most part, and liberals are aware of some of the issues that I've been bringing up. I mean, they're not like radicals, but they're aware of some of the issues. And so what that meant is that the most crucial part of making the TV series was finding the right collaborators and having A24 and HBO agree to these collaborators. And I'll just give you one example. You know, Park Chan-wook is really the auteur that drives the whole enterprise. He was my first choice for doing this work. And again, it's partly about the art. If you know his work, you know that he has a really fantastic visual style that I felt was appropriate to the adaptation. But more than that, I felt that his movies expressed a political and artistic merging of sensibilities that were very much in alignment with mine. So I'll end with the fact that in a recent event, he was asked why did he want to adapt this novel? And what he went on to talk about was not only about the art, but about the fact that he felt that Korea and Vietnam had parallel and intersecting histories because of all the things that you are very well aware of. And he used the word imperialism. I don't know how many times I've heard people in Hollywood use the word imperialism. Zero. And so therefore, I knew that he was, again, the right person because he understood that you cannot actually, if we're dealing with Korea or Vietnam or the diasporas or the consequences, art is not separable from these political questions that have completely shaped Korean and Vietnamese histories throughout the 20th and early 21st centuries.
Hi, my name's Ivana. I'm an MPP 2 at HKS. And I think throughout this panel, I've been reconciling with how we sort of move forward with these contradictions and in terms of advocating for and telling the stories of our community members, however defined, Vietnamese, Bangladeshi, AAPI, BIPOC, immigrants, refugees, who don't agree with us. What does that mean for us to move forward with the contradiction of like telling their stories, advocating for them? I hate to be practical, but I guess like our classmates and professors at the Kennedy School like will and do ask us like, well, what do we do about this? What's the policy recommendation? I think I just want to learn better how to better respond to people outside of the community who don't understand these nuances and contradictions because we've chosen to be in this line of work. What do we say?
Can you just give an example to work with?
I mean, like, I think at the level that we're at, it's saying, like, isn't it good enough that you run for office, that you're, like, a Vietnamese person or Asian American person who, like, is at the table? And, like, in this panel, I think we've broken down how that's, like, clearly not enough. But how do we explain that, communicate that without, like, exacerbating the problems that we're trying to represent and solve, like, at these policymaking spaces?
Shahab, do you want to start with that? Because actually the last answer you were giving was sort of pointing in that direction for how you engage.
Yeah, Ivana, that's a beautiful question. It's something I'm wrestling with every day. I think we are seeing sort of what, you know, we're noticing like kind of what's happening right now in this current political moment where you have a whole bunch of folks that are representing a particular ideology or group or are the first of their, you know, the first of their community to be elected into office and are now getting tons of pushback because now they're expressing parts of their full selves and parts of the communities they represent in that are in direct contradiction to sort of the federal government's policies on everything from, you know, funding our military to, you know, supporting the ongoing genocide in Gaza. And I'd say that I've seen like how at a very local level, people have been facing a lot of that direct targeting as well. And it's been really, concerning. But I think what's really important is that we start breaking, you know, fragmenting just ourselves from one identity in these spaces and really talking about all the different identities that make us to who we are, right? I think that requires a lot of base building and building up the kind of organizations necessary to actually change the narrative on a lot of these fronts. It requires to like truly lead to a lot more variety in tactics so that, you know, we're not just NGOing sort of the problem, but rather we are actually through like disruptions, through narrative change, through coalition building, really showing how all our different struggles are linked, right? So like right now we are drawing connections, BOP is drawing a lot of connections between what's happening in sort of in our solidarity, expansive solidarity activism work that we do for Palestine, and also with around like a lot of the Hindutva forces that are stopping a lot of bills to be passed around anti-caste discrimination and a wide variety of other things. And so drawing these connections, building up that power, developing relationships, right? Like number one, I went to policy school too, fun fact, right? 5+ years ago. Number one thing, my main takeaway, build relationships, right? The people you see next to you are going to be your friends for life, or they will be people you interact with over and over and over again, because they have the same similar interests. They have shared connections. They're going to operate in similar policy spaces. And one thing I've noticed time and time again is that those relationships come in so clutch and key when you need to, you know, think about how to tee up or frame something in particular. And so for me, I think a lot of it deals with the framing, the narrative change, and then you got to get the numbers. And you have to out-organize the other side. And that takes time with relationship building and trust. So.
Great, thanks. I love the phrase, not just NGOing the problem. I can steal that one for the future. Yes, who else do we have? It's here. There's someone here.
Hi, my name is Natasha, and I'm an MPP1 at HKS. My question is, so it's become one tension that I've been grappling with, which is, it's become kind of apparent to me that in HKS and I think other high power organizations, Asian Americans are disproportionately represented, especially compared to maybe Black or Hispanic communities. And I think when we are working in spaces that are focused on liberation and justice, I think one could argue that in the at least in the domestic context, Asian Americans have faced less structural or systemic oppression. So within the borders of the US, I guess. So I'm just curious how you have kind of grappled with this tension of wanting to not pit communities against each other and build solidarity, but also not wanting to take up too much space in liberation and justice work.
Do you want to have a crack at that?
I mean, it's a great question, because certainly there are moments where you do want to do your Asian American work, you know, like when Asian Americans are actually at the center of some kind of political crisis or conflict, like the COVID era and anti-Asian violence and so on. It's important to be assertive and have these organizations do that kind of work. But again, it goes back to this question, and it's, I think it's related to Ivana's question as well. You know, if you are committed to principles before identities first, sometimes you choose your principles before your identities. You gave the example of the representatives and so on. My response to that is, well, sometimes, you know, is it better to have representation at all costs? Or is it sometimes better to think, well, I'd rather have no representation than bad representation? I mean, that's a real political situation for some of us who come from communities that tend to elect people I would personally disagree with very strongly. You know, I'd rather have someone who's not like me in terms of their appearance or their culture, but is like me in terms of their politics and their principles. I think that reflects on what you just outlined. So certainly, yes, there's a role for self-interest and advocacy for our particular communities, however those are defined demographically. But then there's a larger issue, as you said, of identifying the principles that the communities can benefit from, even if they're not benefiting from them directly. So in your examples, you know, like, if as an Asian American, someone involved in policy or representation or something, if one feels that we have had enough, we have gotten enough, then it's possible to advocate for someone else to get a share, a larger share of something. But we have to be able to articulate why, and we have examples of that. I mean, Black intellectuals, Black artists, Black activists, Black politicians have often spoken up for non-Black people, non-Black causes. And it's not disconnected from Black history and Black politics. That's the same model that we should be working off of. I mean, I'm not like an advocate for Palestinians and against the war in Gaza because I'm Palestinian. It's coming out of my history and my understanding of my Vietnamese history. And I, you know, it's important actually to be as articulate about that as possible. So even though, for example, the TV series is out there, everybody says it's about the Vietnam War. Whenever I'm interviewed, I say it's not about the Vietnam War only. It's about American imperialism and it ends in Gaza. I mean, I say that whenever I've been given the chance. And so I think that's true for all of us. I mean, we obviously all work in constraints. You have jobs, you have elected offices. I know you there's the things you say you can say and can't say. But there are things that there's a difference between, number one, it is important to take the risk and say things publicly when it matters. But also behind the scenes, you're also saying things that you never get to say in public. And so you can make certain kinds of strategic tactical decisions that are necessary, even if in your mind, strategically, you're planning something else. And so I think that there's an important distinction between tactics and strategies, what can be said out loud, what can be said behind closed doors, as you figure out what the long game is for what you're doing. That's true for art as well. It'd be very boring if you read a novel and that novelist told you everything you're supposed to know. No, I mean, the novelist is doing stuff with another agenda that you don't get to see. And I imagine politics and policy works in pretty much a very similar kind of fashion.
I mean, one of the things you've been talking about, Shabab, is precisely trying to build those bridges across different communities. And I mean, one way is principles, as well as the other way is finding sort of common practical grounds on economics and needs and so forth.
Yeah, finding those common grounds and needs are like really, 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 really important. I'd say that something that I've seen in sort of like solidarity work that we're doing on Palestine is just like the need to really be able to center very particular moments where, you know, we similar to what Via mentioned is in Bangladesh community, I think a lot of people feel what's happening in Gaza, the solidarity has been there for 50 plus years. You know, including economic boycotts from the nation state of Bangladesh for 50 plus years. We've also seen locally, so BAP is part of the Shut It Down Coalition. And so we're one of many different organizations that are part of this coalition that is led by Palestine Youth Movement and a wide variety of other organizations to advance Palestinian liberation. And in the work that we do there, we've helped to shut down, like in unison in Jamaica, Jackson Heights, Ditmas Park, and many other neighborhoods where there are a lot of Bangladeshis, all businesses on full days as a part of their national economic boycotts. And people have felt it. Like, people want to go get their chopped cheese, and they were like, Delhi's closed. That's like a thing, you know? So, and it's, you know, it's a reminder for that as well. And so I think a lot of it is like taking the step back, knowing what resources you have access to and, you know, giving your shared platform so that things happen that way. And I think centering around needs, like understanding what the need is in a particular time, especially when it comes to the anti-war movement, right? Like all this that's happening right now is directly linked to a new, I think, rekindling of the anti-war movement that we have not seen in 20 plus years since the war in Iraq, right? No, we've, on a weekly basis, this Shut It Down Coalition organizes a protest in New York City. On average, we bring out thousands of people at each protest. And the most recent protest that took place in March averaged anywhere between 20 to 50,000 people. People are angry, and we want to use those opportunities to identify like what the shared needs are and like really be solid allies and keep on fighting and keep on raising awareness for like what's happening right now.
Thank you so much. So as a fairly new implant in the US over 2 years ago, I have a different sort of a question. And that is that I have been able to claw my way into these predominantly white supremacist spaces by way of my proximity to whiteness. And that means
how articulately I'm able to speak English, if I'm able to talk about Descartes, Kant, what's happening in the lives of the Kardashians, and so on and so forth. And so within classroom settings, that means that I'm often only looked as an oppressed class, as brown, Muslim, Pakistani, and also Pathan. That means that I am the oppressed class. So how do I assert my politics in a way that doesn't essentialize my oppression and does not reduce me to the common app version of myself, you know?
It's a tough one because you're also a woman as well. And, you know, the particular kinds of politics and so on that you outlined or identities are more at the forefront of American consciousness right now than the Vietnam War, you know. You know, honestly, for Americans, the Vietnam War is history at this point. So it's not, it's like, well, we fought a war, who cares, you know, so it doesn't really matter. But the things that you're talking about are very much in the foreground. I don't really have an easy answer for you. You know, I don't think those tensions really go away. And I think that I can't really give you a prescriptive answer because each of us has to make our own decisions about how confrontational we need to be and when. And for me, it was always strategic because somewhat like you, but in a less, I think, precarious situation, oftentimes I'm the only non-white person in a room as well. I mean, Hollywood's really white. Senior levels of academia and administration are really white. For me, when I was an undergraduate and graduate student, I never said a word. Look at me now. So I learned how to speak. I learned when and how to speak. I learned when and how to be confrontational. And for me, like, I'm not actually a very confrontational person in person. I'm very confrontational on the page. And I don't have a problem with that. I'm very confrontational when I give speeches. I don't have a problem with that. But, you know, over dinner, I just like to have a good time. You know, it's like, I'm not, or a department meeting. Do I really want to spend my energies in a department meeting having a fight? No, I don't, honestly. And so, you know, I think of myself, I've always thought of myself as a spy. And that is, it's a survival strategy. And it's really a real survival strategy for me. And so writing a novel about a spy was actually semi-autobiographical in that sense, because the spy fights his battles underneath, out of visibility, but the battles are real. That's a different personality. It's a different strategy than the person who wants to have a face-to-face confrontation. If you're that kind of a person, do it. You know, that there's room for that. But my own personal strategy was to always smile, always be nice, and then plot my battles elsewhere. Those things worked for me. I mean, they had real long-term effective consequences. But that may not be enough for some. Some people want to have, you know, if some people will want to have the direct confrontation, will want to pick their battles with their colleagues in their institutions face-to-face. We need those people too. So again, I don't have a prescriptive answer for you. It's just that, again, there's differences between tactics and strategy. You have to have, I mean, for me, I had to have a long-term vision of where I wanted to be. I felt like I had to survive in academia. If I could survive in academia and get tenure, they can't fire me. And I mean, that's literally what I was thinking when I was 21. I was like, I'm going to get tenure. They can't fire me. I can do and say whatever I want. And that's exactly what happened. So, I mean, there is an obviously intense personal and external pressure to say and do something in and of the moment, regardless of the consequences. But if that costs you your future in that area, then is that really worth it? The danger, though, if you go in that kind of line of thinking, and I've seen this happen to people, like, okay, everybody gets, there are a lot of people with tenure in academia, and there are a lot of people who don't say anything when it matters. So it's totally possible that you could engage in this strategy. And then when it really does matter for you to speak, you're no longer capable of speaking. There's real danger in that. And so again, that's why, you know, it's important to have principles. It's important to have vision. It's important to know your voice. And that may take you a while to figure out what that voice is. But all those things, I think, are absolutely, I mean, they're important for writers, they're important for politicians, they're important for people who go into policy and so on. But I think in all of those arenas, there are going to be these crucial questions about your tactics, your strategy, what your ultimate plan is. Like, you should have a master plan. Master is the wrong word. You should have, you know, a campaign in your mind with an objective. It might take you 30, 40, 50 years to get there. That's really important. So it's not just, I know you're feeling a lot of pressure, like, what do I do now? But it's not just about now. It's about what you're going to be able to do 30 or 40 or 50 years down the road when you will hopefully have real power. And when you have real power, what are you going to do with it?
Do you have any thoughts on that?
That was so beautifully said.
We're getting near the bewitching hour, so the last question.
Okay, so I'd like to build on something that Vian... Oh, I'm Jay Rosengard. I teach at the Kennedy School. I'd like to build on a point you made, Vian, for shop. And that's the idea of representation based on principles, ideology, versus maybe ethnic or cultural identity. In your mobilization, let me give you an example from Southern California with the Hispanic community, where one of the kind of unexpected adverse effects of having representation based on Hispanics representing Hispanics was a kind of a political exclusion and a very unhealthy dependency on these elected leaders who maybe did not work in the best interest of the community, mainly using language as the leverage. So a specific question for you, in your political mobilization, do you find this dilemma sometimes and maybe campaign for a non-Bangladeshi who might better represent what you think are the core interests of the community?
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I think there have been instances in prior, in the 2021 New York City City Council election cycle where that arose, where there were multiple Bangladeshi candidates that were fighting in the Democratic primary. We ultimately decided to endorse a particular candidate, but a lot of the community actually thought otherwise and voted for other candidates. We disagreed with what the community thought was in their best interest. It was a long time individual that lived in Jamaica and was just, you know, involved in sort of the involved with particular types of communities within the Bangladeshi community there, specifically in the real estate space. And it was quite unique in that it kind of created a situation where, there was tensions with our values. I guess I'm giving an example that's opposite of this, but basically we ended up going with the candidate that aligned with our values, did a lot of organizing with them, ultimately didn't win, but the rest of the community actually decided to go with another candidate that did. And we think that it did not fare our community well and still is not faring our community well right now as we speak. But if we faced a situation like that, which I think we've seen with AOC actually in particular, so when Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez is a very, you know, very well-known elected official, represents a lot of Bangladeshis in Astoria, Queens, and in Parkchester. And every year, every cycle, will face a challenger, right? Someone's guaranteed from the right to send a challenger to her. In one year, they actually sent a Bengali auntie that represented the GOP at that time and was just not aligned with our values at all. I'm blanking on the person's name. My apologies for that. And but it was one of those moments where we're like, look, you know, AOC's been showing up, has actually helped secure grants for our communities, has done a lot of work, and just again, non-Bangladeshi, really aligned with our politics, fought for us and is continuing to fight for us in Congress, and helping to shift sort of the Overton's window on like what progressive policy can look like and what those justice principles can look like too.
Thank you.
Great. Well, thank you everybody for participating, and please join me in thanking our panelists.